name is Matthew Putesoy. My last name is Putchilvoya. That means man with the large brim hat, or it could have two meanings, rifle. This is Supai, Arizona. I was born and raised here. I've been living here for 42 years. The Havasupai people have always lived here, originated from the Grand Canyon many thousands of years ago. They came up from the center of the earth when, long time ago, in the Bible stories, there was a great flood. Our stories are similar to the Bible, where we lived through the three worlds. The one world where we originated from was the center of the earth, center of the world. A long time ago, the people came up from the ground, and this place of origin, we call it, is in the confluence of the Grand Canyon, where the canyon meets the Colorado, and we've been living here for many thousands of years. When we first originated from the earth, there were four races of man from the center of the earth. These are the four sacred colors: red, white, yellow, and black. Once they came out of the ground, the red people stayed here. The yellow people, the white people, and the black people went their separate ways. And so now we say that towards the end of the world, the end of the creation, the four races of man will unite again. This is the story, a prophecy that's been told by our people for many years. And that's our origin story. We lived here in the Grand Canyon for many years. Our place of Aboriginal homeland, 10, 15 miles from the Grand Canyon National Park, is a place we call Wikidwisa. This is a place of origin for our people. This is where we've been living for thousands of years. And that's a very sacred place for us, our people. And when the people came from across the sea to take over this land, the continent, they moved us from our Aboriginal homeland into this land we now are standing in. It's Havasu Canyon. We've been isolated here for many years, many, many years, hundreds of years now, since the people who came across the sea, the ocean, divided and conquered the people of this continent, the original inhabitants. We're now misplaced from our home. Our home is the Grand Canyon originally. So the National Park Service, the Forest Service, now are making these boundaries to where we cannot go back home to our land anymore. So we now, this is our permanent home in the Grand Canyon. And it's also told that towards the end of the man's evolution, that we're going to one day return home to our land at the Aboriginal homelands that were our lands before. This is why the Nau people, our councils, are working towards expanding and moving out of the canyon here. And we're starting to develop our homes up at Grand Canyon National Park. It's called Supai Camp. That's where we're living too before we moved down here. And we're starting to do expansion up on the plateau lands to where we could have more room where our people are growing nowadays. We're going to start to move out of the canyon to live on top of the plateau. And it's been prophesied too, one day the Supai Kachina will leave the Supai Canyon and come up on top of the world and tell the people of all the bad things that have been happening on the Mother Earth, the pollutions and the global warming and things like that will be told by a member of our tribe. And this guy, this is not going to be a normal person. It's a Supai Kachina. going to have many blessings with him, like a medicine person. He's going to go out of the canyon and warn the people of the coming of the end of the world. So with this, we call this land Havasupai in English, but Havasupaja means the people of the blue-green water. We take care of this land, we take care of this canyon with the spring waters, the sacred spring waters that we're created from. And the land also sustains us and the animals, the birds, the plants that are in the canyon. These are all sacred elements that make up us as a human being. And we call this canyon our home. We will continue to live here, thrive here, as long as we keep our sacred covenant, our sacred songs, our sacred dances, our sacred ways of planting the corn, the squash, the watermelon. These things have sustained us through the dark ages. As long as we keep our covenant that we will be living here and continue the old way like we have for thousands of years. We thank the Creator every day for allowing us to live here, to be able to live under the title Guardians of the Grand Canyon. That's very, very sacred for our people. We need to continue teaching the children about who we are, what we are, and the messages that are brought forth from our teachings, our elders. We need to continue educating other people, other nations that come here to visit us, to take care of the land, take care of the water and the air. These things are sacred, these things that allow us to live and continue living. The Havasupai people membership is 670 tribal members, elderly, children, men and women. Around 450 live here in the canyon alone. The other 25% are living outside of the canyon. And the way we live here is through some economic development and the jobs that it provides with projects, certain projects like trail renovations. Our main source of revenue is the tourism with our waterfalls and the canyon lands and hiking and horseback riding. These are the things that we get our revenue from. Tribal members rent out their homes, their horses. Tribe runs the tourism office and they have a lodge. We have a 24-room lodge that can be rented to the tourism. Also the campgrounds, we can camp 200 to 300 people every weekend. And this is the main part of the village. This is the village square. The road you see coming down through there is the main trail. We call that Supai Main Street. And as you see, we have no traffic. We have no traffic lights. There's no cars down here, only horses. And sometimes people fly in on the helicopter. Behind me, where we did the interview, is the landing field, the landing pad. He takes people in and out of the canyon to go shopping and do other things. And this is where most of our food are brought in by horseback. And also adjacent to that is the U.S. Post Office, the mule train mail. And this is one of the last places on in the United States that still delivers mail through the horses and the mules. We have the cafeteria. They serve anything from fried bread to Indian tacos. And they have the basic foods too, like beans, hamburgers, French fries, and sometimes even beef burritos are sold here. Coffee, orange juice, and water, things like that you can find in the cafe. Far right, we have the Supai Clinic. People who are sick or ailing can come here to the clinic and get some medication, or in extreme emergencies, they call the helicopter and they can air vac people out of the canyon. And right down the street here we have the Havasupai Elementary School. Starts from K through 8th grade. A lot of our children go to school here. There's probably about 90 students that go to school here from first grade to 8th grade. And once they graduate from 8th grade, then they go up to school, boarding schools up on top of the rim. And some students go to Flandreau, South Dakota, some to Shamawa, Oregon, some to Anadarko, Oklahoma, and some down to Sherman, Riverside, California. We have a tractor that's operated and run by a solid waste program. And once these bins get filled up, the tractor comes and pulls it back out to the landfill, where we have trash baggers that bag up the trash. And the tribe also has contracted packers, trash packers, who pack out our trash on a weekly basis. And that's how most of the trash is taken out of the canyon. More solid waste things, more solid waste, you know, bigger items like refrigerators, hot water heaters, and other items, large items like that, are usually flown out in bulk by Air West, who owns a Huey helicopter, and they could contract with them to fly out the whites on the part of the tribe's business, the leaders, where we meet and discuss things that affect our community. Or the tribal leaders, where we have our meetings, is the building to the right. Right there is our tribal offices, where we have seven council members who oversee the tribe's best interest. The tribe membership elects the officials and through a general election, and that's how we select our leaders. And the seven-member council takes seat here, and the tribe also elects the chair and vice, who are the official at the top leader of the tribe. This long time ago, they were known to as a chief and a little chief. So now, since the adoption of the IRA, Indian Reorganization Act, it's now a seven-member council member who oversees the whole best interest of the tribe. And right here is the Supai Bible Church, and people go to church here Sundays, and sometimes evening worship. Have a pastor that is a tribal member. And I think this was built back in the early 1900s by some missionaries. And this land here is leased to them by a tribal member to continue the Bible studies. Now we're ready to go down to the waterfalls to look at some of the falls that are down here in Havasu Canyon. These are waters from the springs that we have, and the water flows down into the canyon, like 50-foot falls, Havasu Falls, Mooney Falls. We'll go see those falls today. Okay, we're down here at the waterfall, first waterfall. This first waterfall we call Tanakva in our language, Tanakva. That means where the water drops off. And this was renamed by the English when they came. They called it 50-foot falls. And it used to be one of the very favorite swimming holes of the people here, because of the real deep turquoise pools that were here for the people and the tourists coming here to swim. And then one time it used to be 50 foot where the water drops off and there's be a nice big pool and a rope swing. But in 2006, there was a series of flood that hit the village, and it took most of the pools away out through here and knocked off the main stream bed. The main stream bed goes right along there and drops off of Navajo Falls. But now the flood hit and it created all this new channel through here. This first fall is called 50-foot falls. The new falls that was created by the flood of 2006. This falls here is fairly new, 2 years ago. And during the flood, after it washed out the main channel to Navajo Falls, it created this new channel and created the new waterfalls. And right now it's called We Hachakema, but in English it would be translated Rock Falls. And this is a temporary name. I think the tribe and the tribal members are getting ready to name this falls and give it a permanent name, so it'll be on the map. And the people living here, it's a combination of both the water and the people. So Havasua means blue-green water, and Paja means the people. So we put that together, Havasupai people in English, but in our way, in our language, it's Havasu Paja. Some of the songs that were sung in the beginning was heard from the waters, and the waters sang to the people. And so that's how they heard the songs, and that's how they started singing. These are songs taught to our people from the water. And we're created from the water. We're born from the water, from Red Butte, Wikidwisa. That's south of the Grand Canyon. That's where we say we were born from, in that area. From the water, the sun, and the earth. So the water is very sacred to our people because that's the giver of life for our people. It gave life to us and helped us, sustained us here in the mountain of the canyon region. Here in Havasu Canyon, one of the oldest man-made irrigation systems is here. The irrigation system we have is over 500 years old, and it's been used many, many years to continue to garden and feed water our crops, our corn, watermelon, squash, and this is part of the covenant that we keep with the Creator. It's a promise that we made that we would continue to plant our corn, water our crops, and continue to live here to self-sustain ourselves. And that's what the irrigation system here is for. And it's been maintained every year. The men go out and clean out the irrigation system and get it started so people in the community can plant their corn. And that's how we continue to sustain ourselves here in the canyon. And if you can see to the left, we have some corn fields and some fruit trees that are planted here. Some of the plants that you see are apricot trees, peach trees, fig trees, pear trees, pomegranates. The ground is very fertile and we can plant up to many different variety of foods. late in the summer in 2006, a flood water came down the canyon, Cataract Canyon, through a series of storms that happened on the 15th of, I think it was July 15th, 16th, and there was a flood that came in through the canyon about 15, 16 feet high of water came through the village. That's where Navajo Falls used to be until the flood came, and it cut that new channel right below 50-foot falls and created the new waterfall along there, and it now has created this new waterfalls through here, and it's now lower. So a lot of the people, the children, like swimming there at the new falls. But that's where Navajo Falls used to be, right along there. This canyon is part of the tributary of the Cataract Canyon, and it's known as Havasu Canyon. From here on, it drops down into this small narrow canyon below here, and from here on through the canyon is the campground where many tourists travel from all over the world to come and enjoy the water here. There's a spring water, natural spring water that people can drink from. There's one about 200 yards from here that very, very good, clear, pure water. And one located here at the bottom of Havasu Creek that you can drink from. And these are not processed water. It's from the Mother Earth, the womb of the mother. And these are very clear waters that people can drink from. There's many, many different kind of species of plants, willow, cottonwood. We have a lot of datura, wildlife, raccoons, ringtail cats, California condors all live here. And the bighorn sheep come into the canyon and drink from the water. And you see them sometimes, but sometimes they're away from any human contact. The bighorn sheep is one of our sacred animals. We have many eagles, hawks that fly in from the mountain ranges, and they do hunting and gathering here in the canyon. Many, many of our tribal members come here to swim and offer prayers for the water to continue to flow. And this is a sacred ritual that we do. It's part of our culture, our history, is to offer prayers to the canyon and the water. And we do that through the sweat lodge too as well, you know, sweat lodging. And to keep things in balance with the water, the land, and the earth. Giving special thanks for the life to continue here in the canyon, with the water to continue flowing, and the people to continue living and planting and living off the land with their growing crops, and continue to live our traditional lifestyle that we have been for thousands of years. This is Havasu Falls. This is where our people get their name from the color of the pool down here. The water gives off this turquoise, blue, green water color, and that's from all the elements, natural elements that are flown through the sediments, and it forms this pool down here at the bottom. There's lime deposits that are flowing over the falls into the water that creates the blue-green water look once it reflects the sun. And this is Havasu Falls. It's, in our language we say Havasua, Havasua, Havasua. That means blue-green. And put that together, Havasu Baja, That means people of the blue-green water. This is where we get a name from, a very special name that the other tribes around the region, like the Hopi, the Apaches, the Navajos, and Wallapais, this is where they get the name from to name us the people of the blue-green water. And these waters are very sacred to us. We say once a person dies or passes away, the spirit flows through the water and dives off into the water pool, and the mist that's created from the drop of the water, the plummeting of the water into the pool, the mist that flows back up is spirits of our ancestors, that, and they continue to fall into the water and rise, and that's how these waters are very sacred, and that sings a song while it drops, flows back up in the mist. That's what these waterfalls are for, to continue the life after you're gone. You're still here with us as a spirit, and that's where the water flows through, and the spirits flow through the water and swim back up in the mist. So these waterfalls, we call them Mother of Waters. And they've been here for many thousands of years, and we're glad to have you be a part of the water. Once you come down and camp in our campgrounds, you stay in our lodge, and you walk the bottom of the canyon, you're walking among our ancestors who've been here thousands of years, and you're part of the canyon now that you walked the sand and the water and the air that you breathe and the rocks that give off the heat. So with all that, with all the elements of life, then you're part of the canyon now, part of the Grand Canyon, part of the Havasupai people, and as part of the guardians of the Grand Canyon. We hope that these messages that we're telling you can be heard and honored and respected. These are what make up our people as part of the canyon, part of the Grand Canyon, as guardians of the Grand Canyon, to protect this sacred canyon from any destruction. Like President Roosevelt said, we should mar at it and not destroy it. And that's what we're here to do as keepers and guardians of the canyon, to honor it, respect it, and protect it. Invite you, the people from all over the world, from all over the country, to come and visit us and be a part of this canyon, be a part of the people. I invite you to come and spend some time with us in the canyon. We're very very good, hospitable people. We invite you to be a part of us.